I have watched every single episode of Game of Thrones, and while I don't know if this was the best episode, I can certainly say it was the most satisfying. And on that note, some people have been saying that season 7 is playing out like fan fiction, and true to form, this episode played like a fan wish list, with check after check after check. Check next to things I didn't even know I wanted to see, but I'm so happy I did. By the way, before we get into the top 6 moments of the episode, I'm 110% Team Dany. I'm throwing my full allegiance behind her, as would any sane person who saw that magnificent battle. Talk about shock and awe. But while I'm fully Team Dany, my first moment has to be frickin' Bronn. Wow, the John McClane of Game of Thrones. What a cool guy. His character arc this single episode was insane. Like, he started out talking about rewards, feeling it was time for him to have a castle, right? He jinxed it. He totally jinxed it. Also talking about where he came, you know, his past in life. And then think about it. Even his arc as a character in general, he goes from the sewers of the Seven Kingdoms, like just like a nobody, to taking part, no, actually, I'm sorry, turning the tide, or at least, you know, landing quite the shot in one of the most epic battles in the history of the Seven Kingdoms. Oh my God. Like, for instance, like, let's just go through his battle moments. Like, I gasped when the Dothraki took off his horse's leg. Gasped out loud. That's how invested I was. I was so afraid so many people were going to die during this episode that I didn't want to die. I'm surprised also how much I was like, I think I'm genuinely going to miss these characters. But anyway, we're just talking about Bronn right now. Then also the long take when he ran through the fire to get to the spear gun. That was so cool. It had that great, like, it wasn't too shaky cam, but it was just enough to feel realistic. I loved when the dragon flew overhead through the smoke. I mean, like, they've been saving their dragon money, and I'm so glad they blew it all in this episode. It was glorious to behold. And then when he got to the spear, he got that guy. He got that dragon, and he had to reload 3 times. Oh, but it was even so cool when he thought he shot the Dothraki guy when he was waiting for him. When he pulled back the flaps on that, and he was like totally John McClane already, and aiming to go, and he speared him. And it was so great, and he kept his cool, and even though he missed. Couldn't believe Dany didn't turn around once he fired the first time. I was like, oh my goodness. She's a very lucky individual. and then, as if all that wasn't enough, he still managed to save Jaime's life at the very end of the episode. And I'm sure he'll save it at the beginning of the next one. I hope so. We'll talk about, I have a little send-off thing about Jaime at the very end. I've cheated a little bit. I have like 6.5 moments. Okay, so anyway, well, Jaime's also featured in one of these moments. But the next moment, I think this is really important, is the mount that this, I think this battle perfectly illustrated like the evolution of war and weaponry throughout the history of war in real life in a single fantasy episode. That was really neat to see. Like, you had classic warfare versus guerrilla warfare. It was like the British versus the Americans. The Americans versus the Native Americans, right? You know, the way battle is evolving in the Middle East, right? It was just fascinating, just the way that was represented, just by, you know, Jaime Lannister's army versus the Dothraki, right? Then you had the importance of air power with Dany. Then how bigger weapons on one side lead to bigger weapons being built on the other side with the reveal of that amazing spear. That was, like, Qyburn really outdid himself on that. I was like, bonus for you this year, buddy. That was, you know, I think he's having a great year. I'm sure Danny's like, why isn't my hand that effective? But then also nuclear weapons, how the dragon fire reduced those in its path to ash, and how tragically fitting on the anniversary, by the way, of Hiroshima. And then also the most basic lesson of war, which is never underestimate your enemy, which Dany totally did with Bronn. Oh, it was amazing. It was so cool. I just really enjoyed it. As someone who likes history, that was an extra added layer of enjoyment to the episode. All right, next, moment number 3, even though they never spoke and Jaime didn't even know Tyrion was there, their connection across the battlefield was amazing. And also, you know, Tyrion watching his brother. And by the way, I was like, someone needs to invent, you know, wireless communication, because Tyrion should really be, he's like, I want to talk to you and I want to talk to you. They say necessity is the mother of all invention. So Tyrion, start inventing. But then also for him to watch Jaime's misguided goodness from afar. And that was really on display just by Tyrion being there. You know, like Jaime still fighting for Cersei, but his just love is so misplaced. But his love also allowed Tyrion to go free and would therefore led to this moment. Like Jaime's kindness and his faith in his family just keeps coming back and biting him in the butt. And also his honor. A good night until what seemed like the very end. He had multiple opportunities to flee. Bronn told him to flee, and he wouldn't do it. Ah, I have even more new respect for Jaime. I can see what Brienne saw in that guy. Although we'll talk about Brienne too. On a side note, he really could be such a cool guy, Jaime. He's got Bronn. Now they've just added this new guy to their bro pack. It was really amazing. The next moment, number four, that crazy will they or won't they, oh forget it, they totally will meeting between Dany and Jon. Like, I wasn't sure where they were going, although I was like, he's giving her intense bedroom eyes throughout this entire meeting. This is nuts. Although I thought that the fire reflecting off of Dany and her hair was quite flattering. I was like, this is a good look for you, Dany. You should have all your meetings down here. But when he took her wrist, he's like, I want to show you something over here. And then he grabbed her wrist. I was like, oh my goodness, he totally likes it. Like me and Davos, if we were standing next to each other, we'd be exchanging looks, we'd be jabbing each other. We'd be like, that's amazing. We'd totally be like Dany and Missandei when they were talking about their, with Grey Worm. And Dany was like, oh my God, you didn't. And then I don't think it was lost on Dany that that's when Jon Snow walked up and she and Missandei basically like erupted into a fit of giggles. It was hilarious. Okay. Then moment number five. I really liked seeing the Stark children reunited, far more than I ever thought that I would. But I think a lot of that goes to the actors who made their characters seem, you know, they've gotten older over the years, but they seemed more mature and more world-weary as well. And that's the acting. So I was really impressed with that. I loved it when Arya and Sansa were looking at the Ned Stark statue, and it was almost like, you felt like they should be like, season one, man, can you believe how far we've come? That was like really funny. And now that Brandon Stark is talking more, I'm enjoying him not only as an asset to the Starks. You know, it's like every team should have a teleporter. Well, it doesn't hurt to have a telepath either, a psychic. It's like, wow, this is really going to help, as you can see from the preview for the next episode. But I'm also enjoying seeing him begin to manipulate the pieces on the board. Like, I believe he handed that dagger to Arya for a reason, and he knows it. We didn't know how well off we were with Littlefinger, right? Because Brandon is turning out to be an Omega level manipulating creep. And I thought Littlefinger, by the way, was so funny interacting with these kids, like some like mom's new boyfriend trying to make nice with the kids, even though he like has no interest in them. Or does he have no interest in them? I thought it was interesting to see him really get an interest in Arya based on her practice session with Brienne. And that's the final moment I want to talk about because there was a lot going on here. It was amazing. First off, should Tormund be worried? I felt a little bit of maybe a spark between Arya and Brienne. I don't know if it's because they're so alike, if they just respect each other. I don't know. But, I was like, Tormund, you better make your move. He's like, I'm trying. She's not interested. I'm like, you know, you're dancing around too much. You know, you just got to go for it. I was also, I have to say, very impressed with Maisie Williams. Not only her acting this episode. It's the first time I've really, really been impressed with her. But also her swordsmanship and her mobility. I mean, I don't know if that was her when she did that great, like, leg flurry thing on the floor to hop up, but a lot of that swordsmanship was her, and she was really good and very convincing. But while Arya might be acting older, in some ways she's still a kid, because she couldn't help showing off, I think partially because she could. I think she was excited to be home. I think she's proud of what she's accomplished. I think, she saw a kindred spirit in Brienne. And maybe, you know, with Sansa being Lady Stark and Bran obviously having these otherworldly powers, she was like, oh, I've got skills too. And I think she played her hand too soon. I mean, it was a really amateur move. I mean, she's a great fighter, but her strategy needs work. She needs sessions with Littlefinger, and I think Littlefinger is planning to have sessions with Arya. But I believe even more interestingly, of equal interest, is that I think that Sansa views her as a threat now. Now, maybe you could say Sansa is like, wow, for her to be such a good fighter, she must have gone through some really bad stuff. I'm sorry I wasn't there for her. But I don't think someone who keeps company with Littlefinger and continues to seek his counsel and says she and openly admits to admiring Cersei to people who hate Cersei, keep your guard up around them. You know, I think she's not sympathetic to Arya. I think Sansa would maybe potentially see her as a threat for who should be the coolest Lady Stark, right? We'll see what happens. And also, I have to say, this episode was no better evidence that we need a Game of Thrones movie, and that one would be amazing. But let's see who's left standing by the end of the show, because I almost thought that Jaime was going to buy it this episode. I thought that's what they were going to do. I was really nervous. I was starting to think about what I was going to say about him in my review here. And I have to tell you, I was genuinely sad. I was like, no, it's too soon for Jaime. Like, I don't want to do it. Just please capture him alive. How? I mean, did they give, like, some illustrations to these Dothraki warriors before they went on the battlefield of, like, who were important players that we want to take alive? Like, that's one of the, I was like, if they have, like, regal colors on, I want them alive. I don't think the Dothraki would listen anyway. But thank goodness it was all just a false alarm. And I think, I mean, I'm still a little scared about him sinking at the bottom of the episode. But I'm confident they're not going to get rid of him just yet. So maybe they'll fish him out and he'll be a prisoner in that regard. Maybe that's what they'll do. I think that's probably what they're going to do, right? He's like, I'm a prisoner again. I think that's how he and Bronn actually met, right? They're like, good old times. But wow, what an amazing episode. Share your own thoughts down below. And thank you for watching with me. And of course, as always, you can watch some other episode, some other of my videos right now.